four decades, starting in the mid-50s and culminating with an album out this year called Way More Blues Part 2. He has influenced vocal and instrumental styles. He has shaped musical attitudes, started major trends. He's had number one hits over and over again through the years. And he was the first country artist to ever go platinum. He's one of the reasons why country music is so popular on the radio today, yet country radio really doesn't play him. His name is Waylon Jennings.
We were the music. We had a song we could sing.
This is the video from Waylon Jennings' latest release, Way More Blues Part 2. Not since 1975 and Dreamin' My Dreams has an album captured the full range of Jennings' talent so well. Produced by mega producer Don Was, who's worked with The Stones and Bonnie Raitt, the Nashville Rebel proves that he's still got it 40 years into his storied career.
We were survivors, good hearts, body and soul. We were the winners, we didn't know we could fail.
The new album, Way More Blues Part 2, a lot of great songs on here. I'm wondering, when did you write them?
Within the last 3 years. I wasn't planning on recording anymore, you know. Mm-hmm. And then Don Was talked me into doing another album. So.
What was it like working with a younger producer? You've worked with a lot of producers over the years. What was he like to work with?
He was one of my favorite of all times.
Really?
He is the neatest guy you ever met, you know. It's like I've never seen anybody so artist-oriented. And he really cares about what happens to your songs. And he knows what it's like to write songs and have them come out not right, you know. And the best thing about him, though, is that he cares what you think.
This great relationship between two giant talents made the music that much better. His albums haven't always worked out so well. Even so, his vision of what his music should be has always come first. But country fans don't hear Jennings on the radio anymore. He may be hip and cool and a legendary star and making great music again, but he's not young country.
A lot of us are going to need a job in about 4 or 5 years. You know, they're, it doesn't matter. See, I mean, if you see this, the audiences, we draw steady all the time, everywhere I go. And I happen to know that the rest of them don't. It goes from the producers are in control, you know, and the guys that, I guess it's kind of like when I started, I'd done anything to get to sing, you know, and they're the same way. They're young, and but they don't last for about 3 or 4 years, and that's sad, because some of them are really good. But the records companies have got ways to get all the money to start with, and then the deals that are made between the record companies and radio. Now, they don't want people who have big money contracts. I have a big contract, you know. But I won't sign one that ain't, because I know where the bodies are buried out there, you know. I also know where the bodies are buried with radio, you know. Those people in poor little things down in the South, what's going to be funny is when they find out that they're letting a bunch of Yankees tell them what to listen to.
It's ironic that one of the artists most responsible for shaping what we now know as country is being shunned, not by his fans, but by radio programmers. It's like pop radio not playing the Beatles, or rock radio ignoring the Stones.
They have a real jerk attitude about it. It's kind of like this guy. One time, I was not too long ago, I was in L.A. And I hadn't been wearing a hat in a long time, so they go by the 8x10s that are assigned to them. That's the ones they know, you know. Mm-hmm. And he's backstage somewhere like here, you know, mm-hmm. shaking hands. Hi, I'm so-and-so, and I'm with Young Country. And all this, and he turned to me and he says, "Hi, I'm so and so, and what is your name?" And he said, "Who are you?" I said, I'm Waylon Jennings." "Oh," he says, "you and I have an interview." And I said, "No, you can." I said, "That means we had an interview." They don't want to play anybody that's over 40. I don't know what that's got to do with music.
It doesn't happen in other art forms, in other music forms, rock and roll.
They're a bunch of jerks, if you don't know the truth about it. And and most of the radio, these guys, nowadays, a disc jockey is a hired hand because they got some people they really pay the big money to tell them what to play.
Straight out of nowhere.
Jennings is intimately familiar with radio. His first job in 1955 was working as a disc jockey in Lubbock, Texas. It was at that time that he would meet a man who would change his life, Buddy Holly.
It was called KLLL. Me and Buddy Holly did some of the commercials and things together, singing them.
Do you remember any of them?
Yeah, let's see here. From the Great South Plains, you hear a fierce yell. Somebody yells "Suey" on KLLL. Mighty, mighty pleasing. KLLL. That was to, of course, to White Lightning. We do it to the, you know.
Buddy was a big influence on you and your career.
Buddy and I were real good friends. Yeah, I've played bass for him for the last month or so, you know, of his life. But we've been friends for a long time. He was a hillbilly. He was country.
Holly, of course, died in a plane crash that also killed Richie Valens and the Big Bopper. Jennings was supposed to be on that plane, but had given his ticket to the Big Bopper. Waylon went on to create a new music, one that combined the rock and roll he learned from Holly with his Texas country roots. His accomplishments since those days are too many to detail in such a short time. But it's interesting to note that after all the innovations, the awards, the hits, the albums, the tours, Waylon and Willie, the boozing and the drugs, the movies, the contracts, the collaborations and the history making, it still comes back to trying to make good music.
I'll tell you what, when you get everybody and everybody in sync, the music, the words, the people, and everything, there's not much better than that.